and our hearts unveiled to receive from you the word of life in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Father, Lord in heaven, we are not ignorant of the devices of Satan the devil. He is walking about seeking whom he may devour. I pray that he will not find any one of us in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Therefore, Lord, this morning I exercise authority, power, and dominion over the plans and the plots of Satan the devil. Amen. Father, Lord, let all his works be frustrated in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Oh, Lord, I pray that you will do something spectacular, something beautiful, something wonderful in our lives today again through the agency of your word and your spirit in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
I pray, Lord, that you will visit us in a special way.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name, I have prayed.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Brethren, we have come to hear the word of God again, to sharpen our lives for the new day that the Lord has brought us into. And we're going to look at the word of God titled, Preparing for the Moment. Preparing for the Moment. What moment are we talking about? We're talking about the moment of our departure from this side of eternity. We're talking about the moment of our death. We are talking about the moment of the rapture, whichever one comes first. But there is a moment that we need to prepare for, and that, you know, with all, you know, amount of readiness. You know, the way you prepare for going to work, prepare for going to do a business, preparing for being one thing or the other, you know, will determine how well you are going to do, you know, when that thing eventually comes. So if you are actually preparing for the rapture, at what time it comes, you will not be caught off guard. You will be in the number of those that will fly, you know, to be with the Lord in the sky. But if you didn't prepare and you just live your life anyhow, and you are not waiting for the appearing of the Lord in the air, at his coming, you will not be aware. At his coming, you'll be disappointed. That is why we are looking at this message this morning. I'd like you to look at the turn your Bibles to Amos chapter 4, and we'll be reading from verse 12. Amos chapter 4, we are reading from verse 12. I read, it says, therefore, thus will I do unto thee, O Israel, and because I will do this unto thee, prepare to meet thy God, O Israel. Prepare to meet thy God, O Israel. We live in the days that has actually brought us very close to the coming of the Lord. And yet it appears that we are not really preparing for the coming of the Lord. We live our lives as though we know when the hour will come. We live our lives carelessly. And that you can tell by the way that we talk, you can tell by the way we comport ourselves, by the way we relate one with another. That tells you that actually many of us are living our lives in a state of unpreparedness, not really ready for the Lord. If we understand what the Lord is communicating to us here in this verse of scripture, we will prepare to meet him. Prepare to meet thy God, O Israel. Prepare to meet thy God, O children of God, on the mountain of solution and redemption prayer ministries worldwide. Go with me to Matthew chapter 26. I read from verse 2. We need to look at people in the Bible that actually prepared for that very moment. We want to begin with the Lord Jesus Christ. I said, the Son of Man that he was here on earth, he actually prepared for the moment that we're talking about, the moment of his departure from the earth. Matthew 26, verse 2. Ye know that after 2 days is the feast of the Passover, and the Son of Man is betrayed to be crucified. He wasn't taken unawares. He knew that his departure from the earth was imminent. He knew the word of God written concerning him. He was expecting it. He was preparing, you know, to depart from the earth. And he prepared so well. You know, at a point, he was really concerned about what was going to happen to his disciples if he left them here, you know, behind on earth. And so he took time to talk to them about his departure, to encourage them, because when they heard about it, they were sorrowing, and to make them to understand that it was needful for him to leave so that the Comforter will come, so that things will happen as set by the Father in heaven. And so he prepared their mind. He got to a point where he took them to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray for the preparation of his departure. Finally, he had been preparing all the while by the life he lived, by the way he conducted and comported himself, by the way he related with his disciples and the people that he was preaching to. The people all around him, the scribes, the Pharisees, he made them to understand the need for them to be saved as part of his preparation to leave. Because he said, a little while I'm here with you, a little while I'm no longer going to be with you here. And so the time that you have me with you here, you hear the word of God and do what you are being told to do. Because in a short while, I'll be gone. Those were the preparation that the Lord made. When he got to the Garden of Gethsemane, there he prayed. You know, when he knew what was going to happen to him very shortly, he knew the pains, the agony that he was going to suffer, he went to pray. He knew that it was going to be a tempting period. He went to pray. How many of us are actually preparing ourselves in prayer, knowing that our departure from the earth may happen at any moment? It is the moment, the most important moment for us to prepare for. We prepare to go to appear before, you know, a panel of, judges that will award you a contract, a panel that will assess you to give you something that will perish on this side of eternity, something that you're not going to cross over, you know, to the other side, that you will not go with into the grave. If you think about it, that where you are going to, you're not going to carry anything material outside of this world. You are only going with your soul. Then you will spend more time to prepare for your soul. You spend more time to think about it. You spend more time to meditate on the word of God. You spend more time to pray. You spend more time to do everything that you need to do to be able to touch the lives of people around you, that the Lord brings your way every day as you live on the surface of this earth. Jesus has showed us the example to follow, that every day as we live, we are drawing nearer and nearer to our departure. We are nearer our salvation than when we first believed. You believed maybe just yesterday, believed 3 days ago, 1 week ago, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 20 years. You are drawing closer and nearer to your time of departure. That should make you to be getting ready all the time. The fact that you got saved just 2 years ago does not mean that your own rapture will be delayed, that those who got saved 20 years ago will go first. No. As you got saved, you are supposed to be preparing constantly, all the time. I'd like you to turn your Bibles with me to St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 18. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 18. And I'm going to read from verse 8. St. Luke's Gospel. First of all, I'll read from verse 1 and then jump to verse 8. I read from verse 1. There it is written, and he spake a parable unto them to this end. This was the reason why he spoke the parable, that men ought always to pray. Men ought always to pray. Why should men pray all the time? As you walk on the road, why should you pray? As you sleep on your bed, why should you pray? As you are at the place of work, why should you pray? On the bus, why should you be in that mood of prayer? I take you now down to verse 8. So I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? At what time he comes, shall he find you really expecting him, prayerfully expecting him, expecting the Lord will make you to do what he has commanded. He has commanded for us to reach out to the lost with the word of God. He has said unto us, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. If you fail to do that, it means that you are not getting ready for his coming. It means that you are not really preparing for his coming. And if he catches you in that state without doing what he has commanded, if he catches you not being, you know, faithful to the word that he has given unto you, then you can judge yourself whether or not you'll be raptured, whether or not you'll be qualified to go with him. He said, nevertheless, in spite of all these things, nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, when he comes as a thief in the night, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith in the earth? Shall he find you ready? Shall he find you praying? Shall he find you living holily, righteously, godly, soberly in this present world that lies in wickedness, full of evil, full of all sorts of things that are causing distraction, calling your attention away from the Lord every now and then? Will you still be standing and trusting the Lord, standing and expecting his coming? That's the question before you. Shall the Lord find you faithful at his coming? Praise Master Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
To look at another man also that was privileged to know that the time of his departure, the moment of his departure, was at hand. And that is no other man than the Apostle Paul. Go with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 5 through to verse 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 5. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry as somebody that is watching for that moment, that is waiting for that moment, that is preparing for that moment. See what you are called to do. Number one, he says, watch thou in all things. In all things, be watchful. In all things, be prayerful. In all things, be preparing. In all things, be waiting, not knowing when he will come. He's coming suddenly. He's coming unexpectedly. He's coming unannounced. He's coming like a thief in the night. I read that again from verse 5. But watch thou in all things, not in some things, in all things, watch thou. He says, endure afflictions. There are the afflictions as you travel on this narrow road. The Lord is saying, be watchful. As afflictions come, be watchful. Be ready. Be in that constant state of preparedness for the coming of the Lord. It goes on to say, do the work of an evangelist. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel as you are waiting for the imminent return of the Lord, because he's surely going to come. If we fail to do the things that he has commanded us to do, it goes to prove the fact that we are not really expecting his coming. We are not waiting for him. That's why we live our lives as though maybe he's not coming, because the world is not expecting him. If we don't do what he's saying to get ready for his coming, we are now like the world. And if he comes suddenly, as I said, he will catch us in the same state that the Lord will be in at his coming. And that will be a very sorry state for the Lord to find you in, a state of unreadiness. If he finds you in that state, brother, sister, sorry, you are not going to go with him. You are not going to be raptured. And so what should we do as the Lord is calling us to remembrance of the word of God that is unfailing, the word of God that is unchanging, the word of God that is the same yesterday and today and forever, the word of God that Paul the apostle had and prepared as we are reading right now, the word that Peter had and prepared, the word that Philip had and prepared, the same word. God is not going to alter his standard or lower his standard for you, for me. No, he's not going to do that. His word stand sure. His word will never fall to the ground empty without accomplishing the purpose for which he has sent it. He sent his word to get us ready so that we will not say we didn't know. The world is not reading the word of God. They don't know what the Lord is saying. You have the privilege. You have the access to the word of God. I have the access to the word of God. What are we making of the word of God? What are we doing with this wonderful and precious opportunity that the Lord has granted unto us to have the Word of God, to read the Word of God? Many, many years ago, people went to church without having access to the Word of God. Only the priest would pick up the Word of God and read. And any interpretation that they give the people about the Word of God, that's all they take. But today, things are different now. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
I have a copy of the Bible that I can carry everywhere. You have the copy of the Bible, you know, in your cell phone. You can read it in the bus. You can read it in the in your closet. You can read it in the washroom. You can carry it everywhere. You know, you have the Word of God in the audio format. You can just put the headphone on your ear. You are riding in the bus or driving, and the Word of God is, you know, hitting you, speaking into your mind, speaking into your heart. Many years ago, people didn't have this opportunity. So we are a blessed generation. But what are we really doing with this Word of God? What difference is it making in my life? What difference is it making in your life? Why are we wasting the Word of God? Why are we wasting the Word of God? God has done everything that needs to be done to get us ready, to keep us on our feet waiting for His coming. Let us live our lives anyhow. The Word of God should make us stand strong to the very end. Let's read and see what eventually became of Apostle Paul, having this knowledge of the imminent return of the Lord. I read again from verse 6. For I am now ready to be offered. How did Apostle Paul know that he was ready to leave? How did he know? It means the Lord revealed it to him to say, hey, Paul, you are ready to leave now. Whatever it takes for you to do, put your house in order. Set things right, because at any moment you are going. That is the moment I'm talking about, preparing for the moment. The moment that will catch or is catching many people unawares, unready, unprepared. Will you be in that number that will be caught unprepared of God? I pray you will not be in that number. I pray I will not be in that number in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
So the Bible says here, for I am now ready. Paul the Apostle is talking here like his master Jesus Christ. I am now ready to be offered. I'm now ready to be offered. I am now ready. And the time of my departure is at hand. He knew. It did not just, you know, catch him off guard. Because he was praying and preparing for it, God revealed it to him. You are about to go. Put things right. Get ready so that when the time comes, you are ready, good to go. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I have fought a good fight. Remember, in this passage of scripture, he was actually addressing Timothy, the man that had been working with him, a fellow laborer, a co-laborer, going up and down with him. And he was saying, look, these are the things I have done in preparing for my departure. For you to depart in a ready state, you are supposed to do the same thing. And as he was talking to Timothy, the same thing he said to Timothy, he's saying to you and I this morning, if we learn. He said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them. Also, the Lord is appearing. He told Timothy, I love the appearing of the Lord. That's why you see me walking hard like this, running up and down, traversing the old heart to make sure that the Word of God gets to the people so that I will fulfill my ministry. I'm making full proof of my ministry. What he said to me, Timothy is saying to you and I, are you making full proof of your ministry? How many lives are you impacting with the ministry that the Lord has given to you, the ministry of an evangelist? Are you doing it? Am I doing it? I pray the Lord will have mercy upon us and give unto us all that it takes to fulfill our ministries in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen. Let's turn our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 38. I read from verse 1. Isaiah 38 verse 1. I'll be reading, talking about Hezekiah, King Hezekiah. In the Old Testament, this is somebody that also, you know, was privileged to know about the time of his departure. Now, and the same reason that the Lord gave here is the reason that will be given to you if you are privileged to know. The same thing is given to every one of us that generally has said, get ready because you don't know when it's going to happen. I read here, in those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amoz, came unto him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order. That's the key phrase there. Set thine house in order. Are you working every day to set your house in order? If we know that the coming of the Lord will be like a thief in the night, then every day we are setting our houses in order. As I'm talking to you, I'm talking to myself. How many times we live our lives not setting our house in order? There is chaos everywhere. There is a lot of things not settled. If the Lord catches us in that state, if he meets us in that state, then we will not be qualified to go with him. We will not be qualified. Here again, what he said to Isaiah, as I continue the reading. Thus, he said to Amos through Isaiah, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Thou shalt die and not live. That's something I want to challenge us with the message we are listening to this morning. Something that should get you thinking as a Christian that loves the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ, as a Christian who really wants to make it to heaven. Now, if you look at Jesus Christ, we've read his own account. You look at the man, Paul the Apostle, we've read his own account. And you look at this man, Isaiah, whose account I've just read now. You will see that something common, that these people were preparing for their demise, for their death. It's not exactly the same thing for those people who are preparing for the rapture. I'm going to point out, you know, what the difference is now. And if you take it to heart, it's going to help you. You will know that if God is saying you are going to die in a few hours' time, he leaves you with the opportunity and the privilege to say, God, have mercy upon me, sort me out now, that I don't die with this sin in my life. You are calling, if there's somebody to call to make a restitution that you have, you know, delayed for a long time, you have the opportunity to quickly do it. And then, if you die in that state, you are sure to go to heaven. But it is completely different when it comes to preparing for the rapture. For these people, they knew what they were preparing for. Just one thing, because they got the privilege of knowing what they were preparing for. In your own case and my own case, we are preparing for two things. One of them will happen before the other. I'm preparing for my death. At the same time, I'm preparing for the rapture. I don't know when I will die. You don't know when you will die. Young people die. Middle-aged people die. Old people die. So not knowing when you will die means that you're also preparing for your death. Don't say, I'm preparing for the rapture. I'm preparing for the coming of the Lord. And you think that's all you're preparing for. But then preparing for the rapture is more difficult. And it's more involving. Now, you will know that very shortly as we read the next scripture. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'm going to read from verse 52. I read, In a moment, no any other warning will come from the Lord. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. It's going to happen in a moment, in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye. Before you close your eyes and open, it's gone. So you are not left with any room to make your ways right. You are not left with any room to call somebody and say, ah, let me make my restitution now. So if there is anything that you have to do, this is the time to do it. The next hour may be too late. The next day may be too late. The next week may be too late. The next month may be too late. Don't put off your restitution for, you know, an opportune time that may never come. You may never have the opportunity to get things right. The time you have is now. Now. You don't know what will happen the next moment. Just as you are preaching now, in a flash, it could happen. So you can see now that it is more demanding preparing for the rapture than preparing for your death. Because preparing for your death, God said, you are going to die tomorrow, put your house in order. Or you are going to die shortly, put your house in order. You can call your wife, and then settle things with your wife and call your children, settle things with them, your people around you, your colleagues at work, the people you have offended, and set things right. But for the rapture, it's not like that, my brethren. That's why we need to be ready for his coming at all times. If you are not ready now, if I am not ready now as I'm speaking, it means we are not really preparing for that. Although we are saying the rapture is coming, I'm going to join this holiness movement or that holiness movement. I'm going to, you know, do something about my dressing, and you stop adjust your dressing. Have you not just fooled yourself? You stop adjust your dressing. Nothing more than that. Restrictions are still there to, you know, be taken care of. You have failed to do them. And then we come every day, we challenge ourselves. Yes, sometimes we just pray and we go, we hear the word of God. But the weightier things are not being taken care of. The weightier matters of the law are not being taken care of. Righteousness, holiness, and all those things that really matter. The weightier matters of the law, we left those ones unhandled. Then all that men can see, all that's what we are concerned with. What, as far as men can see, that we are dressing all right, heaven is sure. Are we not deceiving ourselves? There are things that your pastor doesn't know anything about. There are things your wife doesn't know anything about. There are things that your husband doesn't know anything about. And then you are carrying on with those things, tucked away somewhere in your heart. But you are dressed all right. You know, your speech is fine. The way you comport yourself, all right. The way you relate to people, all right. But there is something in the heart, the matters of the heart, the weightier matters have not been dealt with. You are not ready for the coming of the Lord. Sorry, you are not ready. Remember, he has said, nevertheless, nevertheless, if he comes and does not find you faithful, you are not going with him. I pray that that will not be your lot. It will not be my lot in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Amen.
Finally, I'd like us to read from Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. I read from verse 13. Matthew 25, verse 13. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour when the Son of Man cometh. You don't know the hour. I don't know the day. I don't know. We don't know. Nobody knows when he will come. We don't know. We may be privileged to hear God say, set your house in order, for you must surely die. That was a wonderful, not everybody is privileged to, you know, hear that. We've just read a few. I'm not saying that those are the only ones in scripture. There are others, you know, that God gave them that kind of warning. But for the rapture, nobody is going to have any second warning. No other warning is going to come from the scripture. We have seen that the rapture is imminent. The coming of the Lord is imminent. That's all that we have been armed with, to go and prepare. See what the Lord Jesus is saying here. Watch therefore, knowing that I'm coming like a thief in the night. Watch therefore, knowing that I can show up anytime. The sky can just split open and you see me descending. The sound of the trumpet can just go any moment. If you know that, that is it. Watch therefore, watch therefore, watch therefore. For ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. Are you a sinner? Prepare by repenting, confessing your sins, forsaking them, and then inviting the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart as Lord and personal Savior. Be prepared to do his bidding, and you'll be ready to go with him. Are you a backslider? What are you waiting for? Get restored. Prepare, repent, and ask the Lord to restore you. He will restore you, and at his coming, you will also be ready to go with him. Are you a believer? Get prepared. What are you waiting for? The boundaries are there. Push. Press toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Push, 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 push. Don't be satisfied. Don't think you are a believer, you're all right. You are saved. Are you sanctified? You are sanctified. Are you baptized in the Holy Ghost? You are baptized in the Holy Ghost. Is that all? The gifts of the Spirit are there. Whatever, there's no state you go to and you say, I'm all right. There's always something new. As we yield ourselves unto the Lord and we are pressing and pressing on as believers, The Lord will take us to that ready state before his coming in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Rest on your oars and say, it's coming in 2017 or 2016. We don't know the hour. We don't know the time. May the Lord bless the word of God that we have heard this morning in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise Master Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Just as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be on that day, preparing for our moments. Preparing for the moment, rather. I pray the Lord will help us to prepare not carelessly, but carefully in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Word which speaks matter, our hearts matter, the dressing matter, the food we eat matter, everything matters to God. And I pray the way it matters to God, it will also matter to us, so that we'll be able to prepare in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Out there, you are not born again. Please, I'm begging you, come out of darkness now and praise the Lord so that you will not regret forever. Say after me if you want to accept our Lord as your Lord and personal Savior. The Lord Jesus, I've heard the word. I realize I'm in darkness. I realized that you actually came, you died for me, you resurrected for my sake. Lord Jesus, I come to you today. Forgive me all my sins. Wash me clean. Purge me with your blood. Take my name away from the book of death and write it in the book of life. I accept you as my Lord and personal Savior. Come into my life. Come and dwell in me. I am born again today. All things are passed away and all things have become new. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, for bringing your word my way. Thank you, Father, for saving my soul. In Jesus Christ's mighty name.
Amen.
Declare this declaration. I, as the apostles in the house, and every member of this ministry will rejoice with you. And I know the holy angels in heaven, they sent in heaven, they are hugging Christ now, saying your blood is no more wasted in their life. And I pray the grace will stand strong, to be watchful, to be careful, to be praying and watching, awaiting that day, be given to you now in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. I make you to go back to your vomit. That spirit is dead now in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That day, the future of this world with the hearer and you that have been converted now to the world, we are shall meet the Lord in joy, in glory, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, because I know you answer our prayer again.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus Christ's mighty name, we have prayed.
Amen. Amen.